Welcome, everybody. This is the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of the Catskills service for Zoomers today. Our minister is Reverend Bob Janice Dillon, and I am Jenny O'Grady Giddyy, a member of the Worship Committee and the Worship Associate for this morning. Kathy Atwell is our Shasha. Unitarian Universalism is a liberal religious faith that carries no creed and welcomes all seekers. We are guided by a set of principles and written sources that encompass the many ways we come to know and understand the world, the universe, and the divine. Our principles are important to us at UU Catskills, and we live our values on a daily basis. We affirm that Black Lives Matter. We are a welcoming congregation for the LGBTQ community, and we are a congregational affiliate of the Ulster Immigrant Defence Network, and we are an active voice in the effort to address climate change. Community circles connect members with others that live in the local community. There are 9 circles who meet monthly, so please contact the office administrator if you'd like to get in touch with the circle in your area. If you'd like to contact someone at UU Catskills, for those attending online, a contact list is shown on your screen, or you can visit our website, UUCatskills.org, to find contact information and to be added to the mailing list and to find the latest newsletter. If you're a visitor online and would like to be added to our mailing list, you can put your name and email address in the chat box area of the Zoom. I remind those of you joining us online that during the service, you're encouraged to stay muted. Have a look at the newsletter online and it'll tell you about all the interesting events coming up. And weekly updates are also sent by email. We have 2 announcements for today. Join UU Catskills at Kingston's 2nd annual African American Cultural Festival in the Rondout. It's Sunday, August the 28th. And we're having a UU booth at this event, so we need volunteers to work in 2-hour shifts. Please contact Donna, and her email is below. The next announcement is for UIDN, and UU Catskills has the opportunity to help them this month by providing school supplies to needy families. We'll collect items at the sanctuary beginning today, because I hope many of you are going to dash down to UUCC and help with Blue Jeans Sunday today. And you can make a donation directly to Paula Silby or Kathy Eberlein or to UIDN for their school supplies. Now it's time for our prelude, and I enjoyed this from Mary Evans so much. We played this a few months ago, and I asked Mary if we could play it again. Thank you. it's time to light the chalice. If you have a candle you would like to light, you could get it now. We light this chalice in grateful, loving community. Even in the darkest of times, may its flame light paths to courage, justice, and hope. To join me in reciting the UU Catskills affirmation, may we be reminded here of our highest aspirations and inspired to bring our gifts of love to all living beings. May we know once again that we are not isolated, but connected in wonder and joy to mystery and miracle, in the universe, in this community, and in each other. And I just would like to say before I go on, if you have any messages about the service, don't send them to me in the chat, because I'm concerned if I open the chat, it may disrupt the screen sharing. So send them to Kathy Atwell, and she can always text me on my phone. Thanks. So our opening words, as you know, every week we try and make some remarks about climate change and the threats to our planet, ourselves, and the fellow inhabitants of the Earth. But here finally is some good news. The passing of the Climate Tax and Healthcare Act, the most consequential piece of climate legislation in American history. That's from President Barack Obama. It's been a long time coming, but the Senate has finally advanced transformative climate legislation, said former Vice President Al Gore, who, as you know, wrote An Inconvenient Truth. Now we'll have one of my favorite singers, a Unitarian, Dr. Glenn Thomas, ride out. I think this was an appropriate hymn to choose for today, Circle Round for Freedom.
Circle round for freedom, circle round for peace, for all of us imprisoned, circle for release, circle for the planet, for the children of our children, keep the circle whole. Circle round for freedom, circle round for peace, for circle for release, circle for the planet, circle for its all, for the children of our children. Circle round for peace.
A story put out, published by the UNHCR. And as you know, they've been in the news lately with the Ukrainian refugees and, of course, climate refugees around the world.
Because fire fell from the sky and she was hungry. And no one cared about a child who was alone and terrified. Carly ran and ran and didn't stop until she came to a quiet, peaceful village. Two people sat on a bench in warm sunlight before a house and talked a little and seemed contented. Carly was alone and hungry. She asked if she might live there in the village. And perhaps they also had a little piece of bread or something else she could eat.
"Why, this is not right," said one of the villagers. "A child who wanders about and begs for food? Oh, someone must do something about this. She belongs in an orphanage."
They called the police so that they might catch Carly. But Carly ran away. Carly came to a forest, where she found a few little berries that made her feel a little less hungry. And on some moss, she made a soft, warm bed. But she still needed more to eat, and the night noises in the forest frightened her. No, she couldn't live there forever, all alone. So Carly wandered again through the woods, following her nose until she reached the other side. There she entered the land of the stone eaters. They were very friendly and gave Carly a handful of stones to eat. But she couldn't eat stones. So the stone eaters grew very angry.
"Isn't this place good enough for you? If you won't eat what we have to give you, you may as well leave."
Then Carly thought sadly, "Oh, they don't like me because I'm strange and different from them." And that was true. The stone eaters left her standing there. So Carly walked away. Again, she walked through a huge dark forest. Ahead lay the land of the silk tails.
"Welcome, welcome," they called and asked what she would like.
"Oh, just a small piece of bread, and somewhere to sleep," said Carly.
"That you can have," twittered the silk tails.
But then one of them, standing behind Carly, said in a frightened voice,
"It doesn't have a tail."
Now they all wanted to see Carly from behind, and when they saw that she really had no tail, they said, worried,
"No, no, you can't stay with us. After all, you don't have a silk tail."
"But that doesn't matter," Carly tried to comfort them. I can hang one around me or attach one to me with a safety pin."
"No, no, 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 that won't do,"
cried the silk tails, horrified.
"Only silk tails are allowed to live in our country,"
Carly pleaded and begged. But she had to leave again, even though it was night time, dark and cold. Carly thought sadly, "They won't help me because I'm strange and different from them." And once again she started out, and at the edge of the forest she came into the land of the smoky crows. Here Carly was greeted warmly. One smoky crow offered her a soft nest, high up in a bare tree, and a dead mouse to eat. It already smelt a bit, which made it especially delicious for the smoky crows. But Carly didn't want to eat the mouse. It made her feel sick to her stomach. And she couldn't climb the tree, for it was very tall.
"You must fly up,"
advised the smoky crows. But Carly couldn't fly.
"Oh, there's nothing else here,"
the smoky crows said sadly. So Carly thought, they don't understand me because I'm strange and different from them. There was nothing else to do but move on again. Where the forest ended, she entered the land of the greedy managers. They were rich and lived in large houses and always had enough to eat. Whatever food was left, they threw away. Even their pets enjoyed nothing but the best. When people met in the street, they hugged and gave each other two kisses, one on each cheek. But no one hugged Carly, though her hunger and loneliness were as clear as the nose on her face. Shyly, she greeted two people and asked for something to eat and a warm place to sleep. But her request angered them.
Beat it! We have nothing to spare.
Oh, rich people don't know how much hunger hurts, Carly thought. I must look for poor people. They know how painful it is when no one will help you. She walked to the edge of the city, behind the big factories and the garbage dump. There, poor people lived in small shacks.
Go away, they shouted when they saw the strange child. We've no use for you here. When too many poor people live here, oh, there isn't enough food or space to go around. You have to understand.
So Carly understood that she could not stay there. But she didn't know where else to go. And to add to her troubles, it began to rain. Carly walked out of the city and across the fields. Suddenly, she saw a huge tree. In its branches, someone had built a house out of junk. A man sat at the window, looking out and eating a big cheese sandwich.
Hello! Come over here and take a bite of the cheese sandwich, he called. Oh, you look hungry and tired. Oh, rest here, where it's dry and warm.
Who are you? Asked Carly.
Mr. Friendly, he said.
Oh, said Carly. She'd never heard such a name. Is that what people are called who are kind to others? I've been looking for you for a very long time. If you'd let me, I'd love to come and live here with you and your family. So Carly was invited to stay in their house as long as she wanted.
Now we'll have a song, Whoever You Are, We Welcome You, sung by the UU Church of Kent, Ohio.
Whoever you are, we welcome you. Wherever you come from, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you. Whoever you are, we welcome you. Wherever you come from, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you. Whoever you are, we welcome you. Wherever you come from, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you. Whoever you are, we welcome you. Wherever you come from, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you. Whoever you love, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you. Whoever you are, we welcome you. Wherever you come from, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you. Whomever you love, we welcome you.
That really makes me feel like getting to the end of COVID and getting back together and being able to sing together like that. Now it's time for our weekly donation. Half plate donations for August will be shared with Center for Creative Education. And this is a photo I found from their website. It's a nonprofit community center for arts, technology, wellness, and cultural education. And you can donate using the donate page on our website. And you could use PayPal or mail a check to UU Catskills or a credit card. And our offertory will be "There is more love somewhere." Which is my take on the Unitarian Service Committee. What does it do? What can we learn from UU history? And this is a print screen from the UUSC org website. And these are some of the priorities that they feature: crisis response, climate justice, Central American migrant justice advocacy. So what I'm going to talk about now is how the UUSC came into being, both the Canadian version and the American. So I feel that it behooves us to learn about those who have come before, who paved the way for us, their spiritual descendants, because we can learn from their efforts, their bravery, and their humanitarian deeds, because their works are inspirational, and they give us a sense of pride in our Unitarian Universalist roots. Though we may not be as courageous in the face of tremendous evil as some of our Unitarian forefathers and foremothers were, by hearing of their accomplishments, it might just spur one or more of us to think, well, I cannot go into a war zone and rescue refugees, but I can donate to the UUSC to enable the fearless ones who will follow through on the prompts of their conscience. I can stand on a street corner and hold a sign protesting the treatment of asylum seekers or the erosion of our fellow citizens' rights. We can all do something, be it big or small, to carry forward the light of our flaming chalice. I believe that it gives us a sense of pride in our beliefs, our principles, and the call to action we might feel upon learning about these brave people who have shown us the way. So now let's turn to the lives of a couple of these inspirational men and women, Dr. Lotta Hitchmanova and Reverend Waitstill Sharp and his wife, Martha Sharp. So I'll just go back to sharing the screen. So this is a picture of Lotta. As you know, I'm Canadian as well as American. And so all the years I lived in Canada, Lotta was an icon of the Unitarian Church. And a friend of mine in the North Shore Unitarian Church actually wrote a book about her. And so I'd long wanted to do a bit more research into her life. She was born in 1909 in Prague and died in 1990 in Ottawa. She was the founder of the Unitarian Service Committee in Canada, recipient of the Order of Canada, and she's currently shortlisted to be the new face of Canada's $5 bill in recognition of her humanitarian service. As a Jew, she knew there was a price on her head when the Nazis rolled into Czechoslovakia. She had been studying in Paris at the Sorbonne and was fluent in six languages. But she had returned to Czechoslovakia to become a journalist. However, with the Nazi tanks rolling in, she fled, and she had to keep fleeing from country to country. She was eager to help others, so she took on roles along the way with different agencies, assisting the displaced and hungry. Often she was forced to go into hiding, moving frequently to elude the fateful knock on the door. At one stage, she crossed the Pyrenees. She lived in a shepherd's hut for months, but there was no way to England or America from there. In 1942, Lotta was working as a translator and a teacher in Marseille for a Czech refugee organization. When she fainted from hunger in a busy market line, she was taken to the medical clinic of the Boston-based Unitarian Service Committee for treatment. She stayed in touch with the clinic in the following months when some of her pupils, recently freed from concentration camps, needed to be treated for malnutrition. That was the beginning of her lifelong connection to Unitarians. Later that year, she was able to obtain a visa to board a ship to Canada, and she arrived destitute and alone in Ottawa. Her experiences shaped her actions for her future as she dedicated her life to helping refugees and the suffering of people around the world. I'll just go back to share with you again. She became a well-known personality in Canada, heard frequently on the radio over the decades, exhorting listeners to support the work of the USC. Her visits to schools inspired a number of children, including the acclaimed Canadian singer-songwriter, Bruce Cockburn. She never married, but devoted her life to these humanitarian efforts throughout the world. Thousands gave to help reconstruct war-torn Europe, and then gradually, answering to Dr. Lotter's radio appeals, turned their attention to Asia and Africa. The USC became Canada's first international-focused NGO. This was an article I found online published in Maclean's magazine, which is a well-known Canadian magazine, from 1967. If you haven't met Lotta Hitchmanova, it's probably because you aren't starving, sick, or homeless in a foreign land. And I'll just read a couple of paragraphs from this article that illustrates what type of person she was. In Hong Kong, one morning in early 1967, Mrs. Ho Jo Chin, 35, arose as usual at 3 o'clock and walked several miles to the flower market to buy flowers to sell in the street. She worked through to midday, took the afternoon off to have her 8th baby, a girl, at a nearby clinic, then walked back home with the baby to look after the rest of the family. Her problem was that if she didn't return to work the next morning, she'd have no money to feed her family since her husband was sick and unemployed. By chance, since many thousands of Hong Kong's 4 million people were in similar or worse circumstances, Dr. Hitchmanova heard of her plight. She was on her annual visit to the USC projects in Europe, the Middle East, and Asia, and she arranged medical care for the baby and day nursery care for some of the other children. She also pressed money into the woman's hand and told her through an interpreter that all this was in the name of Canadian mothers. Lotta's Hong Kong diary ended with the comment, "The hunger and overcrowding are unbelievable. We must help more." I'm going back to the screen. Just to tell you about how USC in Canada has changed. The mission is now to support the preservation of heritage seeds and ensure that farmers do not lose access to seeds despite the machinations of multinational companies. It's an equally worthy goal, which also is of benefit to humankind. We work with farmers to grow just, healthy, sustainable harvests everywhere. And this is a print screen from We Seed Change website. From a gravel pit to resilient farm. Farming through hardship. A family farmer in Honduras discusses COVID, hurricanes, and more. 7 seed savers in Mali and how you can support them. Why are local seeds important? This Honduran farmer uses them to help his community. We're going to have a short meditation in the midst of this recounting of the history of the USC. So I'm going to ring the bell, and I'd like you to close your eyes and just imagine yourself somewhere calm and peaceful, perhaps in the woods with the birds twittering, and feeling happy that you are in a tranquil place a place where you know friends are nearby. Help is nearby. You have water. You have food. You can relax. And now it's time to come back as we go deeper into the history. We are not old enough to remember the Munich Pact, but we know our parents talked about it. Almost immediately after the Nazi seizure of power in 1933, Germany began to demand the return of the ethnic German population of Czechoslovakia and the land on which it lived to the German Reich. Sound familiar? We are seeing echoes of this year, 2022. By the late summer of 1938, Hitler insisted upon the annexation of the Sudetenland, a border area of Czechoslovakia containing a majority ethnic population of Germans. At the Munich conference held on September 29, 1938, the leaders of Britain and France agreed that Nazi Germany could annex this territory in exchange for Hitler's pledge not to wage war. Czechoslovakia was not permitted to attend this conference. This is a map, 1939 Europe, of Czechoslovakia. How different things are. Refugees flood into Czechoslovakia. Unitarians in the United States, who had close ties to Unitarian churches in Czechoslovakia, were stunned by the news. Unitarian leaders in Prague soon became inundated with political dissidents, Jews, and other refugees fleeing Germany, Australia, and the Sudetenland, who sought refuge in free and democratic Czechoslovakia. The American Unitarian Association decided to organize a relief effort. Robin Dexter, the director, sailed to Europe to assess the situation. When he returned, he recommended the Unitarians try to help Jews and anti-Nazi Germans from the countries invaded by Germany. In 1940, the American Unitarian Association had created a new agency, the UUSC specifically to aid refugees. In 1939, they asked Reverend Waite Still Sharp and his wife Martha, a social worker, to leave their young children and travel to Europe to help the refugees. I can't believe how cheerful they look in this picture, just sailing off into the unknown. Here's a photo of them at the UUSC office in Marseille. This is where Dr. Lotta Hitchmanova had gone for help. Having narrowly escaped arrest by the Nazis, nevertheless, within the year, the Sharps left their children again and returned to Europe. They opened an office in Lisbon. They focused on aid to political refugees, as well as academic scientists and intellectuals. Martha organized a transport of children to the United States. You see them all wearing the same berets that she had bought for them. This became a model for later transports of child refugees. I was lucky enough to find this video on the internet, and it's part of a Ken Burns documentary. So it's about 8 or 9 minutes long, and it really takes you into what the world was like then for the Sharps.
For a fleeting moment, we had the vain hope that the urgent needs of the Czech people might move the U.S. Congress to open the country's doors.
Martha and Waite Still Sharp had to struggle against the immigration restrictions of their own government.
Our requests for special consideration were being ignored in Washington. The old U.S. quota for Czechoslovakia allowed 2,800 Czechs to enter the U.S. yearly on immigration visas. At that pace, most refugees realized that they might wait several decades to get an American visa. But looking that far into the future was a luxury. For most refugees, their greatest need was finding a safe bed for the night.
There was an enormous anti-immigrant sentiment, anti-Semitism, and deep racism.
No country, literally no country, was prepared to take Jewish refugees. After the Nazis entered Prague, we found out very quickly that to get any further where we could live permanently was nearly impossible.
I shall never forget the shock when I saw a Jewish man being abused on the street. I would have cried aloud in anger if Waite Still had not silenced my spontaneous outburst. All my life I hated unfairness, and as I spoke to individual Jewish refugees, I felt their dignity and recognized their amazing capacity to rise above Nazi mistreatment. On March 24th, I met with Tessa Roundtree from the Quaker Underground. She asked me to help smuggle groups of refugee families by train through the heart of Nazi Germany.
So my father went through a great deal getting a permit to get out. And so there was this problem about how do you get from Prague to London without going through Germany? It is essentially impossible.
The groups included some of the most wanted and well-known anti-Nazis and their families, including one of the most famous surgeons in the world, a female scientist, and two journalists. But of course, we had to hide their identities. They were to leave the country under the guise of household workers, so that if their papers were checked, they would appear to be simple gardeners, cooks, or farmers. Once we made the arrangements to take the refugees on this perilous ride, I didn't know if I would ever see Waite Still again. The train was announced. We got on board. Everyone deeply moved at parting, for they were not sure if we would reach our destination.
We were going from Prague, Dresden, Leipzig, to the Dutch border.
If the Gestapo should charge us with assisting the refugees to escape, prison would be a light sentence. Torture and death were the usual punishments. At the German border, our passports and visas were carefully examined. My heart was pounding as I thought about Waitstill, Hastings, and young Martha Content.
When you got to the border, they came by and said, "Alle Juden aussteigen." All the Jews had to get out. They separated the men and the women. We didn't know if we'd ever see each other again. They checked you, and they really checked you. I mean, they did very careful examination, every possible orifice in your body. At one point, one of these German officers said, "Is that all?" And my father said, "Yes." And they said, "What's that on your finger?" And he said, "Well, that's a wedding ring." And they said, "No, you can't take that with you." So they took it off, and that was the end of his wedding ring. And shortly after the train pulled out of the station, an SS man came. And I remember that. It was a very dramatic thing. So we had the joy of riding with an SS man for 6 hours. I was sleeping most of the time. And my mother was terrified, you know, if I were to kick him or something, then that would be the end of us all.
We're traveling all through Germany. We weren't even allowed to look out of the window, you see. The windows had to be blacked out all the time. And I remember seeing these long periods, you see, when it wasn't moving at all.
At the final border crossing, the customs officers came aboard to check my list against their documents. Then I heard my name called. Two of the journalists in my party were standing on the platform with their luggage, trembling with fear. The officials had ordered them off the train and were going to send them back to Germany because their names did not appear on my list. Quickly, I turned away and added the men's names to the list. These two men are in my party. Shaking his head, he okayed their passports. And we all climbed aboard the train once again.
And then we were in Holland, and I remember my parents being ecstatic.
We arrived in Holland, exhausted and relieved. And then I took the group by boat to London.
I have a picture showing us when we first arrived in England, and it shows the clothes we came in. And they were the Austrian national costume, and those were literally the only clothes we had. We weren't allowed to take anything else.
Dear Mrs. Sharp, we shall never forget what you have done for us and wish to thank you from the depth of our hearts.
Every life we touched had its own drama. One can only manage a miracle every so often, but a series of miracles can happen when many people become concerned and are willing to act at the right time. Waitstill had gone out to a meeting in Geneva, and finally the Gestapo tore up his return permission so that he was not going to be able to come back in again. And then I received word from my underground. The Nazis are going to arrest you and take you to prison. I packed everything I could, got aboard a train, and went straight up to London. I met my husband, and we both sailed back to the United States on the Queen Mary.
As we plowed west through sunlit seas, we were summoned to the Grand Salon. The radio crackled out the news, and we heard the voice of the Prime Minister of England. The Parliament of England declares that a state of war obtains now between the United Kingdom and the Imperial German government, announcing the end of peace in our time. The order had been sent down from the captain's bridge, give her the max. The ship came alive. She hit the great waves of the North Atlantic with such violence, the sea came right over the ship.
We were no longer aboard a civilian ocean liner. We had become a war target. The course of our ship was changed to run north, for German submarines had been reported due west, waiting to sink this pride of the British fleet. Portholes were fastened and painted black to prevent the light from showing. And nobody was allowed to smoke on deck at night.
This was the biggest ship in the world. Of course, she was no match for any German torpedoes. Well, she made it. We landed. And the chapter was over.
We docked in New York, and we're back in another world. Love, children's arms, plentiful food. And the only tension that concerned Americans in September seemed to be which baseball team would win the series. Most Americans were not really concerned with the war, nor did they understand why it was declared. Life was still pretty secure in the good old United States of America.
So, our final song today is Imagine. And I found this version from UNICEF. And I particularly liked it because of its different group of multicultural singers. But wait, you'll see John Lennon here too. And it's all black and white. So somehow it seemed very much in keeping with the video that I just showed you.
Imagine no possessions, But I'm not the only one.